Hi, I'm Jared Potter, and we're talking about designing for Windows Phone 101. The topic right now is the design-driven product. In that, we're going to be talking about three different sections: the tools for a design-driven product, the process, and the team. This will apply not only to some of my experiences on the Windows Phone design team, but also to your individual experiences creating your own applications and software. The biggest dilemma, obviously, as a designer when you're creating these comps is handing off the ultimate vision that you have at the beginning to be created in a different medium. So I have these slides to illustrate. Maybe you have a design and this is your masterpiece that you've worked on and it's an egg, right? And you comp it up and you spend a lot of time and you redline it and you put specs and you say this egg is 18 pixels across, and then you hand it off as a PSD for the developer to create. And at a certain point, that developer or programmer or whoever's working on your team, maybe it's even you yourself, have to create it in a completely different platform. Maybe that's HTML, CSS, or maybe some other form of markup language. And maybe it's XAML on the Windows Phone. And the dev takes that code and they do their work to it, and at some point it sort of loses the original intent. And of course you can't ship like that, so you put the content back together and you ship a somewhat close to the original vision of your product. But the main dilemma is that your masterpiece that you worked so hard on has to be created by someone else, or maybe not, but in a completely different medium with totally different tools, where you were in Photoshop, it needed to be created somewhere else. So one of the things about making it real is sort of taking it from that wireframe or that visual stage and getting it to that polished, beautiful piece that everyone's gonna come to know and love with the final product. One of the things that I like to say about this is just know your platform, right? We could never have a print team where no one back in the day understood four-color print process or cardstock thickness or any of these different things. A lot of times now, UX designers come to a product and they don't put the time and the effort to know anything about the platform they're working on. The best thing and the best experiences are when designers know what the limitations and the benefits that they'll get from their platform. So a couple of tools how to. Know your platform. Designers, learn the benefits and limitations of your platform and work towards those. Try to make designs that are gonna come out the best based on your, whether it be mobile or tablet kind of experiences. Developers, learn the design language. The more that you know and contribute to the design, the more it gives you the vocabulary that allows you to communicate. So the last point is just communicate between all the different people on the team and the different hats that need to be worn to create a great product. The next thing I'd like to talk about is the process. So the process when creating a big project like this can easily be an engineering or a data-driven project. And that's all great and that's fine. But a lot of times along the ways, you'll get really focused on the implementation of something and less on the planning of the goals. You'll get a lot of hacks that you'll have to do at the 11th hour because you've only focused on the experience or the technology and you haven't really thought about the experience and have to sort of recreate the experience at the last minute. It will help you seize opportunities, and at a minimum, thinking about the design up front will allow you some room for innovation. In the design studio, we had a poster that looked like this. It says, explore, which is sort of the planning phase, concept, which is sort of the interaction design of an application, refine that design down, which is the visual phase of the project, commit, which is basically speccing it out, or what we call redlining in the industry, realizing, which is of course building, making it work, and then verify, which is sometimes the most painful part to a designer, but double checking all your screens and re-looking at it and everything. And then end game, which is celebrating, of course, what great stuff that's gone on. So in the process, when you're thinking big, brainstorming in a design studio or brainstorming even with developers and designers, no idea is a bad idea, right? I don't know if you've participated in brainstorming, but it's a good idea to just throw all the pieces out there. There's a couple different ways that we do this. Sometimes it's with sticky notes. Everybody writes an idea and they stick it on the board. And then you begin to start taking all of those and putting them in categories and start categorizing all the different ideas. But the main point is at the very beginning of a product, go big. Think of all your different options. Don't narrow yourself down until you've gotten to the point where you're actually committing to stuff. So How to go big, set a timeline, explore in concept. So as long as you have a timeline to work within, you'll know when to stop that sort of going big piece of it. And go big before you contract and sort of pull the different pieces in. The next phase is the information architecture. When you're looking at the information architecture, make sure that you're starting to put all those different pieces, or if you will, all the sticky notes that you just put on the whiteboard in the right category and saying, when I go to this screen, this is what screen I'd like to go. And this begins to make sense. It's a really great way to start putting all of your concepts in a coherent thought process. Working on that, the next step is interaction, and it's basically a big portion of the information architecture. The only difference between interaction design and sort of the information architecture is when you begin to actually put content or wireframes out on the screen. The next step in that is sort of, well, here, let me start with a couple of refined how-tos or best practices. Establish your goals and principles really early on. So when you've got sort of over that big, go big and coming up with lots of creative ideas, make sure that you establish a couple of the rules, similar to what we saw earlier on of kind of design principles that were used on Windows Phone or in the studio. Come up with those just so you have something to gauge your designs against. Storyboard out your ideas. This is similar to something they do in film, but kind of just take all your ideas from concept to reality and saying, okay, so-and-so is going to use this app. They may need to use it on a bus, and here's the different scenarios. One of the things that I really like to do is create a UI map, seeing how all the screens flow down together. And the most important thing, establish an interaction model. This interaction model needs to be consistent for the user not to get lost in your application. Next is visuals. This is the part that you learn in school. This is the part that you work the most on. I won't give you too much guidance on this because I don't have your application in front of you to give feedback on. I'd love to do that, by the way. But it's basically when you come and take that app and polish it up and pretty it up and make it look beautiful. And the last step, this is something I was in charge of in the design studio, is prototype. This is the stage that your app comes alive and all your hard work is put to the test. When prototyping areas of your app, take the time to sculpt and refine the components that need it the most. One of the things that I like to say about this is do it by any means necessary. Do it with a pad and pen, do it with a camera, but do it in such a way that people can see your concept rather than just hear you talk about the concept. It allows for a much more visual way and it sells your idea in a much more relevant kind of way. So a couple of prototype how-tos. Here's a couple of links. If you just search, do a Bing search, you can do screen design templates for Windows Phone. And these are a bunch of default templates that are provided for Windows Phone. They come in really handy. And then Sketchflow, which is a great blend tool for allowing you to quickly create a bunch of comps on screen, string them all together, and allow you to create hit targets so you bounce through from button to button and actually see all the different screens. In the design studio, we used a poster that looked like this, and it basically talked through the different phases of this. You have wireframes that start out pretty early on, and then you have final visual comps, and look at this, this is mostly in Photoshop or some other program similar. You create some red lines, which is specking, meaning the developer will know how high or how what the actual dimensions of that screen is. You do a little dev coding, of course, and then one of the things that we always did in the design studio is design integration. My title was design integration lead. We always revisited every single one of those screens and went back and made sure they were pixel perfect. And this is the blood, sweat, and tears phase that I love. And then, of course, there's always the test and validation to make sure your code works. So a couple of commit how-tos. Apply final visuals and motion treatment. Of course, don't leave that stuff out. Fold in early learnings from usability tests. Things that you learned early on, kind of that hunches, the creative hunches, the things that I was talking about that was like, use common sense. Using common sense sort of gets difficult in this phase, so don't forget to come back to it. Fix bugs, interaction, visual, motion, and functional. And most importantly, just know with your application to create a user journey. Know your user. I mentioned this earlier. Make it personal, have relevant content, and let them be present in the application. It's very important that the application and the story that you're telling has to do, and the final goal is really going back into that user's pocket. So a couple of process how-tos. Don't lose track of the vision in the day-to-day schedule. It's very easy when you're working on a big project or you've worked on an app for months, weeks, maybe even years, to lose track of the big vision. Always go back to sort of that big timeline and wire your app and what stage you're in. Also, don't skip on the more boring steps. As a designer, going back, like verifying all of your screens and making sure that they look the visual polish that you wanted to at the very beginning, that gets daunting, it gets exhausting. But don't forget to do that. Always be sure to come back to those pieces. The last thing that I like to talk about is the team. And for you, this may be a very large team. For you, this may just be you wearing multiple hats. One day you're the designer, the next day you're the developer, and you switch through it. But ultimately, the design skills that you'll see in a design studio look something like this. You'll have visual design, and it overlaps a little bit with interaction design. There's motion designers out there, and in the design studio at Microsoft, there's a full set of skills and job requirements around motion design. There's an information architect, and they put all the different pieces in the right places. Some people wrap this up in the whole user interface designer bubble. And there's, of course, the user experience designer. But basically, there's a lot of different hats that people wear. There's identity designers and customer service managers and user experience designers. But the main thing is, you may be working with a large team. You may be having to deal with a lot of different skill sets and work on a lot of different individual pieces. When I first started in Mobile Studio, out in Pioneer Square in Seattle, there was, I believe, like 12, 14 people on the team. And when I left the organization at Microsoft, there was maybe 1,800 people on the mobile team at Microsoft. The design studio, and this is a talk that I like, that Mike Kruzaninski, one of the creative directors for Windows Phone, talked about in a talk called Poetry and Polemics. And he talks about trying to get your idea across to a larger organization. And this little dot represents a beautiful idea that you have. And I loved this presentation. And he says, and you may have to spread that idea out to a UX design lead, a motion lead, a PM manager, UX PM. This may be different roles depending on the company that you're at. And then you have to communicate this vision out to a whole bunch of different people. Maybe this is project manager leads or development leads or programmers. And then that goes out to all the different people who are sitting your app out. And at some point in the process, your original idea gets gobbled up. The big thing is to become a good storyteller, a storyteller that sort of crosses all these different skill sets and boundaries so that they can understand what your original goal and intent was with that idea. He also used this example in his presentation. Big, full, and fruity. These aren't words that describe a person or anything. This is more words that describe a wine. And so it's like from the book Gary Wolf, The Quantified Self, he talks about going and doing wine testing. And they were asked to use the words big, full, fruity, all these different words to describe the wines. And he said, well, why do I have to use these words to describe the wine? And the instructor basically said to him, you're being asked to remember these wines. These adjectives are your labels. You're welcome to make up your own, but then I can't instruct you and nobody will understand you. When you're working with a big team on design, learn to speak the same language. It's very important that you have the same nomenclature. In the design studio, originally, not all of the pieces that we're very familiar with design Windows design language actually had names, like tiles didn't have names. So it became very important for us to come up with names with that so that we knew what we were talking about when we were talking about different pieces. Become a good storyteller. Shoot a video, make storyboards, act it out if you have to, but tell the original goal of what you want your feature to be like. Prototype, show, don't just tell. So you can tell, so this first part's about telling, but prototyping and visually showing things off. There's been so many times I've worked on features for little apps or actually the OS where it felt like people were not on board with this feature. It felt like it was gonna get cut. And as soon as we built a little prototype where we could show people what it would look like when they held it in their hands, the idea went straight to the top and everyone was excited about it. And then of course, last but not least, it doesn't need to be said, respect others and their roles. Sometimes you work with people that do very different roles and have very different personalities than you. Try to respect them. That wraps up sort of the design-driven process and the section about how to create things that were led by design.